Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is September 29,
2019. Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to our worship service this morning. We give a special welcome to our visitors. If you're new in the Springfield, Pollock County area, or looking for a new church home, we invite you to know St. John. Your new church home. And this morning I'm throwing a monkey wrench into things. Your bulletin is wrong. We will not be using the service of the word as you see printed. This is the festival of St. Michael and All Angels. The color of the day is white. That's why I'm wearing a white stole and why the communion wear is in the white veil and so forth, but it wasn't necessary to change all the pyramids since it's a lesser festival, not a major festival. So we'll be using setting four like we normally do when it is a celebration of the Lord's Supper. So I will be giving you the pages throughout. We use it all the time, so you know how to follow it. But that is what, of course, for my being in Louisville, Charlene, when I texted her that my mom passed away, she sent a response and said she wouldn't be bothering me anymore, and I forgot that she was going out of town for her son's birthday, so we never were in communication that she needed to change the bulletin to a communion liturgy bulletin because of this being a lesser festival. So after the hymn, we will go to page 149 for the singing of This Is the Feast. So we begin with the order of confession and forgiveness. So I invite those who have that difficulty to please stand as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, fill the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of God. Gracious God, have mercy on us. We confess that we have turned from you and given ourselves to the fire of sin. We are truly sorry and humbly repent. In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things we have done and things we have failed to do. Turn us again to you and uphold us by your Spirit, so that we may live and serve you with newness of love, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We now begin our celebration with hymn number 528, Come and Fill Our Hearts. And you see, we sing it three times, just one verse, but it's done three times. Come and Fill Our Hearts, hymn number 528.
Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Now page 149.
Becky Dimitrov.
revelation. Lord, look out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon and his angels fought back, but they were defeated. And there was no longer any place for them in heaven. The great dragon was thrown down. That ancient serpent who was called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world, he was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven proclaiming, now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Messiah. For the accuser of our comrades has been thrown down, who accuses them day and night before our God. But they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. For they did not cling to life, even in the face of death. Rejoice then, you heavens, and those who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you with great wrath, because he knows that his time is short.
Thanks be to God.
Sure.
church going, asking about Mom's memorial service next week. Mom donated her body to the University of Louisville Medical School, so there is no visitation. Just a memorial service will be at 4 p.m. next Saturday at St. John Lutheran Church on Breckenridge Lane in Louisville, Kentucky. There are sheets on the front pew. If you would like to attend, giving you directions, and there will be a lunch or more like a dinner after the funeral is over. It should be around 4:30 or 4:45 at the latest. Probably. So if you would like to attend, there are directions on the front pew, as well as a sign-up sheets for the next couple of months for readers and so forth. So now, would you give your attention to Becky and me? Chapter of Revelation, I was saying a reading for today, We have what might be called the Song of Glory of the Martyrs, as they sing the glory of Satan's defeat. Now, as we've read in verses 7 through 9, war breaks out in heaven. The devil opposes God and tries to make claim of heaven. But as we read, war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon. The dragon and his angels fought back, but they were defeated and there was no longer any place for them in heaven. The great dragon was thrown down, that ancient serpent who was called the devil and Satan, the deceiver of the whole world. He was thrown down to the earth, and his angels were thrown down with him. Satan. The word Satan means adversary. It means accuser. It is the imagery of a prosecutor in a courtroom, using all of his best skills or her best skills to bring about the conviction of a defendant. The word devil means one who brings forth charges with a hostile intent. So why in the world are there people who become involved in devil worship? Why are you worshiping someone who spends their whole time bad-mouthing you to God and our Savior Jesus Christ? Why would you worship someone who is the biggest loser of all losers? For he is finished. He is defeated. And he knows his time is short. But he continues to roam about the earth, trying to bring forth his church. As we read these verses, we can say they are the cleansing of heaven. As Satan is thrown out of doom, Satan can never enter heaven again. Now we heard Jesus say, I saw the devil fall like lightning from the heavens. And Satan was cast out at the beginning of time. But remember, the Old Testament tells us that for some reason Satan still had an ability to go up to heaven when God called an assembly of all his angels. We read this in the book of Job. And in Job, Satan appears, yet the conversation between God and the devil, God doesn't come forth in English, but in the original you can see God is kind of being sarcastic with Satan and kind of like, what do you think you're doing here? And why do you think I'll listen to you? But anyhow, he asks Satan what he's been doing. He says, I've been going to and fro across the earth and up and down. And God asks him, have you noticed Job, my righteous servant? And Satan says, I've seen Job. But he only is so loyal because you blessed him with every blessing he can have. He has a huge family, a lot of wealth, a lot of influence. If he didn't have that, I bet he would curse you to die. So God allows Satan to attack Job, destroy everything he has, that Job will not curse God. He remains loyal. After the crucifixion of Jesus and his resurrection, Satan has no more privilege of going to heaven. He is stuck on the earth until that final day when he is cast into the lake of fire. So as this all takes place, we then read how John hears this voice of triumph and celebrating, sung by the martyrs, glorifying God, and praising the defeated Satan. The martyrs are those who have overcome Satan. Now let me say that again. The martyrs are those who have overcome Satan. your secular world, and maybe in your own mind, you have always thought of martyrs as being defeated, that they died for the Christian faith. But that is their victory over Satan, because they withstood every temptation, they withstood every seduction, they withstood every threat, and every act of violence. And when Satan threatened their physical lives, instead of renouncing Jesus as the devil, they died confessing Jesus. Just like the martyrs today throughout the world, who died for the faith, who overcome all that evil, because what is most important to them is their allegiance to Jesus Christ, more important than their own life. The victory of the martyrs is won through the blood of the Lamb, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, the Lamb of God who willingly went to the cross that first Good Friday and gave up himself as the final and complete sacrifice for our sins, paying the debt of sin of the earth. And so, dying for the Lord Jesus Christ is not a defeat, but a victory. On the cross and through his resurrection, Jesus overcame forever the worst that evil could do to him and to those who have entrusted their lives to him through their faith in his suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension. Through the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross, sin is forgiven. And when one believes in faith what Christ has done for them, their sins are wiped out. When we are forgiven, there is nothing for which we can possibly be accused. So the devil has nothing. No matter how much he may badmouth us before God, no matter how much he may lie, there's nothing he can accuse us of, because we are washed in that blood of the Lamb. Because we are protected by the cross and blood of Jesus Christ. Not because of anything we do, but because of our faith in what Jesus has done. Why are the martyrs victorious? Because they lived the life of the gospel in their daily lives. As John records for us in verse 11, and they have conquered him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, for they love not their lives even unto death. And they have conquered him, Satan, by the blood of Jesus Christ. And as John writes, and he says they, he's not just talking about his individual Christians, but he's also talking about the church. Our victory comes through the blood of the Lamb. Martyrs do not consider their life more important than their Lord in Jesus Christ, reminding us of what Jesus said in that 12th chapter of the Gospel of St. John, the 25th verse. And he said, whoever loves his life loses it, and whoever hated his life in this world will keep it for eternal life. This is a principle that runs through the entire gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Now what did Jesus say? Jesus is not saying that we have to hate life to the extent that we would draw and become a hermit somewhere and give them all earthly comforts and barely provide for our physical needs. What he is saying is that those who have an affection for a fondness of life over faith will have their lives totally destroyed, utterly ruined, ravaged, and decimated, because they put comfort over faith. They put comfort over testifying to Jesus Christ. They put comfort over being a disciple of Jesus Christ. This is what he is talking about when he says he who loves his life loses it, or he hates his life. The one who hates his life is the one who puts Jesus first. The one who realizes that loyalty to Jesus is the most important thing. And he tells, and Jesus is telling us that it is kept for us unto eternal life. St. Peter picks up that same idea or that teaching of Jesus when in the first chapter of his first letter, verses 3 and 5, he writes, Blessed be the God and Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. To an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. Jesus says, it's kept, our inheritance is kept for eternal life. St. Peter picks up on that by telling us it's kept in heaven for us because of God watching over it. And that word kept means to set aside, to guard for the lost, to keep an eye on. God himself is keeping his eye on our salvation. And it says God's power guarding us through this faith. That means to man and guard, be on watch, or to place in garrison in a strategic place so that the enemy is not overcome. So for us, this is not necessarily a matter of dying for the faith, but of setting loyalty to Jesus Christ before the comfortable way. The biggest danger to Christianity in North America and Europe is being comfortable. Now what do I mean by that? I mean that we become so comfortable with our life that we stop fulfilling the Great Commission. We become so comfortable with our life, everything's going well, nobody's hassling us, because we're not witnessing to Jesus Christ. Because we're not sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ with others. So we can go to work, we can go bowling, we can go play golf, we can go fishing, we can go to a ball game, and nobody's going to hassle us because we're not talking about Jesus. But if we're talking about Jesus, then people get upset. And then life isn't comfortable. But it's doing Jesus good. And it's offering people that purpose on that. Do you know what is the fastest growing church in the world today? And you've heard for years that Africa is the seat of fastest growing area of Christianity. But right now, someone has taken that place as being the fastest growing church in the world. It's not China. It's not North Korea. It's not Vietnam. It's not Pakistan or Saudi Arabia. It's not Iraq or Afghanistan. Anybody want to take a wild guess?
Iran.
What did somebody say?
Iran.
In Iran, the mosques are empty because the church is exploding. And as one Christian said, we don't make converts. that is simply having somebody switch from being Islam to Christianity. So we make disciples. We make disciples who make disciples of others, and that is why the church is exploding in our hands. He said the greatest thing that ever happened to the Christian church was Ayatollah Khomeini. And old Khomeini probably rolling over if he's hearing that. Because he did everything he could to try to stamp out Christianity, to stamp out anything influence of the Western world. If you remember Iran during the days of the Shah, Iran was very Western. The women wore Western clothes, they had Western music, they had Western food. And Khomeini came along and it was back to the 11th century for Iran. But now the people are tired. And it's not just that they want democracy and get rid of the Republican Guard and the mullahs or the imams who keep them in this tight fist. They are flocking the Christian faith as a disciple. That is our biggest danger, is becoming human. We need to be on the edge of the disciples of our time. What does it matter if somebody stops being your friend because you proclaim Jesus Christ crucified? What does it matter if you lose a golf partner, a fishing buddy, or a bowling partner because of your faith in Jesus Christ? The martyrs' loyalty to Christ is so important that they gave up their lives and defeated Satan. But that leaves us with a problem. Satan now has come to earth, and he is not happy. As we read in verse 12, therefore rejoice, O heavens, and ye who dwell in them, as this Satan has been kicked out. But woe to you on earth and sea, for the devil has come down to you in great wrath, because he knows that his time is short. That word wrath means violent passion. The devil has a violent passion to destroy the church of Jesus Christ. For nearly 21 centuries, he's been trying to go away. So kicked out of heaven, he is filled with his wrath. His power in heaven is broken, but he still has power on earth, and he uses it to the others. He rages ferociously because he knows that all he has left is a short time. And then, instead of being the ruler of all things, instead of being filled with glory, he will be in the lake of fire for all eternity. There was a man who was touring Europe, and he noticed that in Europe a lot of cathedrals and a lot of churches would have a lamp carved on them somewhere on the walls. Well, visiting this one church, he noticed a carving of a lamp that was way up on the bell tower of the church, someplace he'd never seen before. So he went into the church, and he asked about the lamp. He was told that when the church was built back in the 11th century, 10th century, the 12th century, that one day scaffolding was up as they were building the wall of the bell tower, and a workman, as he went to lay that stone where the lamp was carved, lost his balance and fell to the ground below. All of his fellow workers scurried down the scaffolding to see what had happened to the friend, expecting to see him lying there, shattered on the ground. Instead, as they came to where his body should have been, we saw him standing up, dusting off his clothes. You see, when he fell, there just so happened to be a flock of sheep where he was falling. And the sheep broke his cloth. At his feet was a crushed lamb.
He said, you come to the land. He said, he was crushed, but I lived. And so the next day, when they went back up to lay that stone and carved that land to remind them one of the miraculous survival of their cohort. Also, so the people who lived up to it, they would be reminded of the Lamb of God who saves the world. The Lamb of God who is our Savior. And because of his death, resurrection, and ascension, he has defeated Satan for all time. So like the martyrs who've gone before us, we can sing that victorious song. Amen. The peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. We now sing With Peace Like a River, hymn number 785, in the back of your worship. Hymn number 785.
104 in the front of your worship book, and by those who can, I have difficulty to please. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and all that is seen and unseen. We believe in my Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things are made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. Was the incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified and brought us aside. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We give you thanks, O Lord, for all the blessings you have bestowed upon us. And we have come at your bidding to plead on behalf of all your people in Christ and for all the people as they have need. Our response today is irreverent. Almighty God, you have surrounded us with your love and favor and sent for angels and archangels, cherubim and seraphim, to do your bidding on our behalf. We are grateful for the many ways that you watch over, protect, defend, and keep us, your people, against the forces of temptation, despair, and evil. Lord, in your mercy. Blessed Lord, you have chosen to work through your people to care for those in need and to extend the good news of our Savior. We are grateful for all those who work on behalf of your mission to witness and service, both here and throughout the world. Lord, in your mercy. Mighty God, you have made all things and given the stewardship of creation to us. Make us wise and discerning as we explore the mysteries of the creative power throughout the world. Remain and keep us from abusing both the gift and the responsibility we have to you and your creation. Lord, in your mercy. Faithful Lord, you redeem us so that we may live new and holy lives, seeking not the desires of our hearts, but your will and command above all. Reveal to us how best to serve you and do your work here on earth, and lead us to show forth our faith, loving, and good works that glorify your name and serve our neighbor. Lord, in your mercy. Loving God, you have borne our griefs and carried our sorrows even to death. Hear us on behalf of all those who suffer illness and affliction of body and mind, and grant them relief, comfort, and healing according to your gracious will. Bless also the caregivers and hospitals, nursing facilities, and homes, that they may act with compassion for those in need of care. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious Lord, you give great blessings, and none is greater than the gift of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the salvation he won by his death and resurrection. Give to us your Holy Spirit, that as we approach his table today, we may be prepared through repentance and equipped by faith to receive his flesh for the life of the world, and his blood that cleanses us from all sin. Unite us as one people in faith and in life here on earth, until together with the saints above, we meet you face to face. Lord, in your mercy. Everlasting God, you hold time and eternity in your hand. We give you thanks and praise for the mighty saints who went before us, leaving us a legacy of faith and faithfulness. Guard us against the distraction of the moment, that we may daily seek your face here on earth, until the day when Christ comes in his glory to bring to compassion all things. Lord, in your mercy. In your hands, gracious God, we commit all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. St. John practices an open communion for all those who are baptized and believe in Jesus Christ as a personal Lord and Savior, who believe his body and blood are truly present as a gathered estate, and are of communion age in their own individual congregation. We invite and encourage you to come forward with us this day as we gather at the table of our Lord. We continue our celebration with a great thanksgiving on page 152.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let's give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
By the witness of the saints, you show us the hope of our calling and strengthen us to run the race that is set before us, that we might delight in your mercy and rejoice with them in glory. And so with Michael and all the saints, with the choir of angels and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn.
Body of Christ.
coming to you. The body of Christ gives 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 you. Glad you could be sent to the places that you have been to the Father, you would just step to the place of such time as we have been here. Father, send us to the body of Christ in the tree. Body of Christ in the tree. Body of Christ in the tree. Christ given to you. The body of 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 Christ given to you. Those who can please stay. The body of the Lord Jesus Christ, whose precious blood strengthened, preserved, and true faith, the life eternal. Thank you.
concludes our 10:30 service on September 29, 2019. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. Join us next week at 9:30 in the parking lot at First Lutheran Church for a combined service with First Lutheran, Good Shepherd, and St. John's Lutheran Churches in celebration of Reformation. St. John's has a food pantry open 9 to 10:45 on Wednesday. Outreach store open from 9:30 to 1 on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. Rainbow table is every Friday from noon till 1 o'clock. Everyone is welcome. Thank you again for joining us. God be with you.